to the Fruity Knitting Podcast. This is episode 26. I'm Andrea.
And I'm Andrew.
Thanks for joining us today. We've got lots to share with you. We have an interview with Tom of Holland, who is perhaps best known for his Visible Mending Program and his expertise in darning and mending, which he teaches in workshops. Tom dives very deeply into whatever fibre art or craft he's presently fascinated with and becomes very curious and thoughtful about the technical processes involved.
Our guest on Knitters of the World today is Rosie, who's coming to us from Edinburgh in Scotland. As we shall see, Rosie is an avid garment knitter.
Yeah. I'm going to show you how I pick up stitches around the neckline of a garment. We've got yet another cow to announce. We've got knitterly progress to show. And we're going to talk a little bit about muscle health for knitting arms.
Yep. But before we go any further, I did want to mention all the program notes for all of our episodes are available at fruityknitting.com. I do also want to mention on that page, you can find an index to all of the guests that we've had on the show, right, for going back around a year. We have over 20 guests on Knitters of the World and around over 20 interviews that we've carried out. You can look up the name and jump straight to that point in any episode, so that's really handy.
Yeah. So let's get straight on to under construction. So the project that I've got on under construction is Daffodil. Here's a picture of it, what it's going to look like at the end. It's from Marie Wallen's book, Springtime. It is by Marie Wallen. And I'm using yarn that I bought at the Edinburgh Yarn Festival, and that's the Hampshire 4-ply by the Little Grey Sheep in the colourway Dancing with Olive. So it's really great wool. It's a little bit rustic, but I'm happy with that because it means that I can wear it a lot. It's not going to peel, and that's what I like. I like to wear my garments a lot and have them look really good after quite a lot of time. So I thought I'd just tell you a little bit about it first.
Allow me.
Oh, thank you. It's knitted. This is the back piece. I've only got about 5 to 7 centimetres to go before the back piece is finished. You can see it's just a big rectangle, so it is going to be a drop shoulder design, but it'll have a slight bit of shaping in the shoulders and the back neck. This is actually a good thing for any all-over stitch pattern because it makes it easier. If you have a set and sleeve, then you have to do all the decreases and make sure that you're keeping the stitch pattern correct. So if you're looking at doing a fancy project but looking for easy ways, this is a good one because you don't have to do any of that. I also wanted to say, if you're looking at the whole pattern of it, like I said, it looks really quite amazing, quite a lot of work, but it's not, particularly if you think about breaking it down into what actually it consists of. So if you see this section here, that's the lace panel, and we've got 1, 2, 3 of them. And the lace panel in itself is not very difficult. It's a pretty easy lace. And then we've got 2 braids, which is a cable here. Very simple braid. It's a 4-row pattern for repeat, and only one of the rows you're cabling. So it's one of the most easiest cables you can do. And then you've got 2 panels here of a twisted stitch pattern. And what I love about the twisted stitch pattern is that it imitates a cable, but it's very delicate. And you don't, often with cables, you get double or even triple kind of bulk. So it makes it very heavy. So you can combine a twisted stitch pattern very easily with a lace pattern and keep the fabric the same kind of thickness and weight. Mm-hmm. And it's just such a delicate effect. So I really love that. And then we've got these columns that surround each of the panels here, and that's just a simple twisted stitch. So just 2 stitches, and you're twisting them either to the right or twisting them to the left. And then, so all patterning, it's a 31 row pattern, but all the patterning is only done on one side of the fabric, the right side.
Dolls, how do you get to a 31 row pattern on that? Is that because of the combination of the different panels?
Yeah, so okay. This is a 4-row pattern.
So do you actually, you keep track of which row you're up to on that 31 rows?
Well, no, because the chart is written very easily for you. So, for instance, this braid here, it just shows you that every four rows you're going to be doing the same cable.
So you keep track of what repeat you're up to on each different section.
No, you don't have to do that.
You don't have to.
It'll show you the row for the whole thing.
Okay, so it's got 31 rows like that.
31 rows, and then you start all over again. But if you look at it, this cable repeats itself a lot more than the other ones.
Yep,
so you don't have to, sometimes you do have to do that. You have to have your charts all lined up and figure, okay, this one I'm still going down on and this one I have to keep repeating. But it's a very easy...
a very easy knit, right?
Yeah. Anyway, the wrong side rows, you're just knitting the knits and purling the purl. So I think that this has got good value, good wow factor for work.
Sounds like good value, yep.
Yeah. So if you want to have something that looks really impressive but actually isn't that difficult, this is a good garment. Yeah.
Good thing.
So you may have seen with this project that I haven't actually made a lot of progress, and I'm going to tell you why. That's because for the last week I haven't done any knitting at all. And you may remember that a couple of episodes back I said to you that my arms were sore and I was taking a short break from knitting. Well, I've been to a doctor and a physiotherapist, and I've been told that I have a mild, relatively mild, but chronic form of golfer's elbow on both arms and tennis elbow on both arms. It's called golfer's elbow because you have a muscle band here, okay, that works with contracting, and a golfer, when he holds his stick or her stick and plays club, they're moving it like this, and this muscle band here is joined with a tendon here. So when these tendons get inflamed, you get pain on this bony part of the elbow. And if you think of tennis, the backhand, doing a backhand, you've got this kind of movement here, and you're working these muscles, which are joined by tendons, onto this part of the bony part of your elbow. So that's why it's called tennis elbow and golfer's elbow. Its real term is lateral and medial epicondylitis.
Epicondylitis.
Whoa. Yes.
Okay.
So that's its technical term. So you can imagine that was pretty hard for me to hear. And I had been trying to control the healing and the pain by not knitting for long periods, and if it got bad, just taking a couple of days off. But it's really not significantly improving. So I've decided that I just have to bite the bullet and do what is best, and that is have a complete break. So I am not going to knit a stitch for at least 4 weeks. That is really hard. Okay, that was hard for me to hear. It's going to be very hard for me to do. It's, to put it in relativity of world problems, it's nothing. It's, you know, it's not a problem. I'm happy, I'm healthy, great family, things are going well for me. But on a smaller scale, it is quite an emotional problem because it's a major part of my life and this podcast. So it's a challenge, and I've had to keep putting my chin up and and just kind of watching my mental attitude to be positive. And in the long run, you just have to look at the facts and deal with it the best way possible. So I can't keep pretending that I can somehow get over it. The fact is, it's not getting better. I have to have a complete break. So that's what I'm going to do. And I figured I'm going to talk to you guys about it, because if I'm suffering this, there's probably some of you are too. And it might just help you in some kind of moral way to keep your chin up.
Yeah, I think it's good to share the experience.
Yeah, you know, because, I mean, I want to also show you the treatments and the exercises that I'm going to be doing, but none of that is meant in any way to be medical advice for you, because, quite frankly, as you know, I'm not medically qualified. And even if you have pain that looks similar to mine, you have to get it medically checked out properly by a good doctor and physiotherapist, because it can be something else. Sometimes pain here can be related to neck and shoulder pain, back pain. So it's really best not to self-diagnose. But I will tell you a little bit about what I've learned. The major problem is tendons don't have the same blood flow as muscles do, so they take a lot longer to heal. So I have been trying to keep this, stimulate the blood flow in this area. You can put, do it with hot water bottles, massage. There's various different things you can do. And I'm also starting this eccentric strengthening. So I'll tell you a little bit about that because I'm learning about it. Apparently the muscle, your muscle sort of has two sections to it. It has the red muscle belly part of it, and that, and then the white tendon part of it. So there's a contractile part of it and a non-contractile part of it. And the contractile part is when you are shortening a muscle under tension, like with a weight, then you'll make that part of the muscle stronger. But you can also, but when you're lengthening a muscle under tension, as with a weight, you're making the tendon, non-contractile part of the muscle. Tendon. Non-contractile part of the muscle stronger. So that is what they say is a very good thing to do for golfers and tennis elbows. So get my trusty bottle of red wine. This is just a cheapy Australian cab sav. And so the whole idea is, for instance, this muscle here, if I hold my hand like this, then it's contracted. And then if I slowly lower my hand, the muscle is becoming longer, so I'm lengthening it. But I've got a weight in my hand, so I'm doing it very, very slowly, and that's strengthening the tendon part of the muscle. Because, as you said before to me, some guys, when they go to the gym and they really work out hard, the red muscle part can build up and be strong very quickly. The tendon part takes longer, so that their muscles can be so strong they can even rip the tendon from the bone, because the bone isn't, it's not very nice, is it?
But
the
no,
bone,
it's the, unpleasant.
The tendon part isn't strong enough. So you really need to develop both so that you are balanced in a strong way. So lengthening, this is eccentric strengthening, lengthening the muscle with a weight like this.
Yeah. I find that really interesting that it's different in terms of which direction you're moving. The effect of it is different. You know, you would sort of intuitively, I would think if you're lifting something up like that and if you're dropping it down like that slowly, then you're sort of having the same impact on the muscles, but it's different apparently.
So. Yeah. If you've got a lot of pain, you just start off with a very, very light weight.
Yep.
Not much at all. And just very slowly, so you don't move it fast. If you move it fast, you're sort of using the gravity or the swing, and you don't get the same effect. But incredibly slowly, just lowering your hand, and that's putting some tension on the muscle as it lengthens. So you might do 3 sets of 10 every day and then increase. And once you handle that, you increase the weight. And then for tennis elbow, you're doing the same thing. If your hand is bent back like this, this is shortened, and you're slowly going to move the arm down, lengthening it with tension, like with weight. So I do it like this. And you've just got the forearm balanced on something flat, lying on something flat. So that's the eccentric strengthening exercises that I'm doing. And you could do this as a preventative. If you don't have any aches and pains, it's not going to hurt you. You can just do this sitting on the couch with your bottle of red wine, put it to better use than drinking it while you're watching telly.
Yeah.
And just slowly lowering your hand and raising your hand. Yeah, so I'm doing that. I'm also doing low-level laser treatment and the photons, is it,
from the light? Yeah, sounds good.
Is meant to penetrate the cells more, activate the repair system and help them get rid of waste. So I'll keep you posted as to how it goes. Wish me luck. And
yeah.
So it means that in the next few episodes you won't see me knitting a project, but I do have other good content planned for you.
Hello, my name is Rosie, and I'm originally from Coventry in the West Midlands, but now I live in Edinburgh. I'm very lucky to be able to say that. We have a wonderful knitting community, some great yarn shops, and of course the wonderful Edinburgh Yarn Festival. I've been knitting for about 4 years now. It all started when some friends bought me a beginner knit your own scarf kit for my birthday, and I had a go and just became completely obsessed and couldn't put it down. I think I always knew though that I would become a knitter one day. My gran was a prolific knitter, so I grew up in bespoke hand-knitted garments, and I've always had a love of wearing woolly jumpers. I've always enjoyed shopping for them and wearing them, so the progression to making them for myself was fairly natural. I absolutely love knitting. For me, it's the perfect hobby. It's a great mix between practical skills and creative skills. So I love that I can spend my time crafting and yet produce something tangible that I have to show for it at the end. I also love how portable it is as a hobby. I take my knitting with me pretty much everywhere, and I manage to get a lot of knitting time in when I'm walking around or on the bus or waiting for something. I also knit in front of the TV, I knit in the pub. Pretty much any time where I can be knitting, I am knitting. And for me, it's great because I get to be doubly productive. So I'm generally always knitting whilst also doing something else. My favourite thing to knit and to wear is circular stranded yoke designs. So like the one that I'm wearing at the moment. I like wearing them because I think they suit me and they're quite adaptable. You can change the shaping to fit you quite easily. I like knitting them because they have a good portion of mindless knitting where you don't really need to think about it too much, and then the fun bit comes all at the end. So I mentioned that I generally knit circular things. I also actively dislike knitting flat and purling, so I'm quite a fan of steeking. And I have no aversion to doing this. I've even steeked some projects where the pattern didn't call for it, just to avoid having to purl. In general, I would say I'm a project knitter. I pick patterns based on things that I just really want to wear and go with that. I do also really enjoy the process of knitting, but for me, it's all about the excitement of having the finished object. Still consider myself a fairly new knitter, and there's lots of things that I haven't tried yet and would like to do more of. I haven't done very much lace knitting and haven't done a great deal of cabling. It's all too easy to get complacent and just cast on another bottom-up circular yoke project. There's something very reassuring about knowing that I don't need to put too much thought into it until I get to the end. So I would like to push myself and do more challenging things. At the moment, I'm knitting a sleeve. I started it yesterday. It's a DK weight plain sleeve. I haven't decided what it's going to become yet. I think it's going to be one of the yokes from Tin Can Knit's newest collection, Heart on My Sleeve, to which 12 different designers contributed a yoke. It's a really great collection. It's kind of modular in the sense that you choose your size and knit sleeves and a body, and you don't need to decide which yoke you put on it until you join them in the round. I tend to knit a lot of things this way by default. Actually, I'll just pick some yarn from my stash and knit a body and sleeves and then find a yoke pattern halfway through. I'd like to show you some of my favourite knitted things. The first one I've got is Cockatoo Bray. It's a Kate Davies pattern from her yokes book. And I absolutely love everything in this book. I've already knit a few things from it and I'd like to have the full set one day. It's a bottom-up fingering weight circular yoke cardigan, knit entirely in the round and steeked up the front. I'd already done a bit of steeking by this point, so I knew that would go quite easily. It was, however, the first fingering weight garment that I'd knit for myself, so that was a bit of a challenge, but I was pleasantly surprised with how quickly it knit up. I'd knitted it in Bahram Eutytus yarn, which is a gorgeous Yorkshire alpaca and wool blend yarn, and I had a set of mini skeins which I could pick from for the yoke, so it was quite difficult putting the colours together, but I was pleased with how it came out. Really happy with this one, and I wear it a lot. The next thing I'd like to show you is a pattern called Field Study by Anne Kingston from her Stranded Knits book. It was one of the first Faroe Isle things that I'd knitted, so it was quite a challenge to take on. It was the first all-over Faroe Isle thing that I'd knitted, and actually still the only all-over apparel thing I've knitted for myself. I think the reason for that is just that I was procrastinating at the time from writing my master's thesis. So clearly I need to motivate myself a bit more to take on some more complex things now. I've got a bit complacent. It was also the first steeking that I'd done. It's mainly done in the round of the body and the sleeves, but there's just a small steek at the front neck here just to lower the neckline at the front. I just love the fit of this one. It's really flattering. It's got a flared sort of hem at the bottom and a lot of waist and bust shaping, quite a flattering line that comes just under the bust here. I also love the way the colours kind of change from dark to light, going from the bottom of the sleeve and the bottom of the body. The next one I'd like to show you is another circular yoke. It's an Icelandic pattern called Hestur Peysa, which I think just means horse sweater. And it's got these lovely Icelandic horses going all the way around the circular yoke. This was challenging in a number of ways for me. I modified it a little bit. So the yoke chart was supposed to begin right after you join sleeves and body, but I wanted a slightly shallower yoke. So I took the first dozen or so rows off the chart and did some plain knitting after joining so that the yoke started higher up. So it's a slightly shallower yoke, which I think for me is a more flattering fit. It also has quite long floats in the yoke with the horses, so I had to learn how to track my floats. Really pleased with how it came out. It's knitted in Icelandic yarn, Letlopi, that I bought from a shop in Edinburgh. But we went on holiday to Iceland last year, and a couple of days into the holiday, a local asked me, "Well, if you haven't been to Iceland before, where did you get your Icelandic sweater from?" So I was quite proud then. The final garment I'd like to show you is a mashup of two patterns. I knitted it for the Tin Can Knits Hackathon that they organised in December. So I took their Gramps pattern and mashed it up with the barbel hat and put that around the bottom. I really enjoyed making my barbel hat, but I knew straight away that I wanted to put that colour work onto a sweater because I am a sweater knitter through and through. So when the hackathon came along, it seemed like the perfect opportunity. I changed quite a few things about the Gramps pattern. So it's a basic top-down cardigan, but instead of knitting it flat, I did a steek, so I did it in the round. Although I knew that I would need to do a steek for the colourwork, or I would want to do a steek for the colourwork, I actually just joined it in the round from the top so that I didn't have to pearl at all. That worked out quite well. I had loads of fun making this one, and I wear it a lot. It's really crazy.
Thanks, Rosie. That was great.
Thank you very much to Rosie. Well, I always think we have... I really enjoy the Knitters of the World segment. I think it's really good. I did mention that Rosie was a prolific knitter, and now you can see I think she really does just knit all the time, walking and talking and knitting at the same time. I always think of... That's what they used to do, you know, when they were working, when knitting was working, they would take it around and do it all the time. So I thought it was interesting that she can do that.
Yeah.
We found out after we got this input from Rosie, this contribution, her husband has also taken up knitting. I suspect I can understand how that happened with Rosie being such a prolific and dedicated knitter. Probably a little bit of a similar situation to us where you said, "Andrew, you should do some of this, you should do some of this," and you're doing it all the time. And eventually, yes, I took it on. Rosie's husband has knitted Rosie a jumper. Not sure how many jumpers Rosie needs.
No.
And I did wonder what happens, just supposing Rosie had a baby. I imagine this baby wakes up in the morning and this baby will have such a big choice of little things to put on.
Yes, from mum and dad. It'll be swimming in knitwear.
Yeah. And I did think, Rosie, she's from Coventry, but I can see she would fit in very well in Edinburgh.
Yeah, Edinburgh seems like such a groovy place to live.
Yeah.
So when are we moving?
Yeah, don't know. haven't figured that
but
out yet.
The Gorge, it's a lovely city, and all that fantastic hiking just like a half an hour drive outside.
Yeah.
I think it would really fit with us very well.
Yep.
And gorgeous yarn stores that she was talking about as well.
Yep.
Yep.
So moving on to my knitting now.
Yes, what
back
have you...
to under construction. This is my Drachenfels shawl. The really exciting thing that happened this week was, do you want to take the other side of this?
Okay.
Well,
so we'll do show the right side.
I'm trying to show the right side.
Okay.
Okay. That's it. The really exciting thing that happened this week was I got to do a line of blue. So that was really nice. There's a bit of variety. I think I have to do something like this here, the same amount on the top.
And you're nearly there.
Yeah. And then after that, we get more blue. So yes. That's going to be really fun. There's the blue.
So this blue will take blue. Over.
Yep.
Yeah.
So stripes again. The one thing I did want to mention, this is all knitting. So that's kind of easy for me, possibly, and it's not a good habit for me to get into because purling was always my challenge.
But you are in good company with Rosie. Rosie likes to knit. She sticks everything so she doesn't have to purl.
Yeah, yeah. That's very good company to be in.
So it's garter stitch.
Yep. So knit and then knit back. The one thing I have sort of picked up, and I think it's probably just a tip from you, am I right?
You're on the wrong road. Oh. You're trying to knit backwards.
Yeah, that'd be right.
He's trying to show off and knit and talk. You're nearly there.
I'm not trying to show off, I'm trying to get through. The one thing that I have learned once I get the knitting around the right way is when I started knitting, people asked about how I would get faster because the speed was a bit of an issue, especially when I was doing my hiking jacket. All right, a lot of stitches in that. There's a lot of stitches in this. When I started knitting, I would hold the needles probably fairly tight, and certainly I held directly the needles. And I actually found it difficult once I got so much material there that I had to put my thumb around the back here, you know, like that. I'm used to that now. What I have started doing more recently, and I think it's also still a gradual process, is grabbing the material down here rather than holding the needle. Yeah. So grabbing it down there. And I think that helps to sort of stretch out the stitches on the left-hand needle and to get the right-hand needle through and do the knit.
Yeah.
So that's something I do still find it slightly uncomfortable, and it depends. It's funny. It depends on where I am in the row. I think right at the beginning of the row, it's a little bit more awkward. I don't really know why. The other thing which I'm trying to work towards, which I'm still also uncomfortable with, is when I do a stitch, right? This is maybe hard to see, but I do a stitch just to pull it around just like that without involving anything else. So sort of simplifying the movement. That's a very fluffy bit of wool there.
It is, isn't it?
It's really weird.
So
around there, that really is fluffy. And just pulling it off like that.
But the reason that is because your stitches are too far back. You want to aim to have your stitches bunched up right before where it goes, it narrows down.
Shuffle, shuffle, shuffle.
And then these fingers here are just holding it from falling off, and you just release it and it falls off for you.
Yeah, something like that. Anyway, do it like that because you can see it happen there. My habit is to sort of do that, to push the needle through with my finger and then let it off.
You can do that too.
Well, I can do that, but it all... slows it down a bit, I think.
Yeah, it depends on how you hold this hand.
I think we went out for coffee. This is a fatal mistake. We went out for lunch with Hazel Tindall.
Yeah.
Yeah, and just ever since then, you've got to feel a little bit inadequate. So, yeah. Anyway, that's my Drachenfels shawl. It's coming along. I haven't calculated how many stitches I've got to go yet. Maybe I should or maybe I really shouldn't, but getting through it. Next on our program, we're bringing the collage of the selfies for our cable garment cowl. We've got 5 contributions here. I'm really pleased with what has come together. It's only a small group. It's a very select group. We've got covered from Northern Canada right down to New Zealand.
Yeah.
And we also have a contribution or even 2 contributions from Western Australia.
Yes.
Which is really remote. We have got incredible coverage there. So enjoy this. I think it's a great, great piece of work. And thank you very, very much to everyone who took the time to put in a contribution to this.
Yes, thank you.
Hi, my name's Kelly and welcome to the Great Canadian North. My mom made me this Alice Darmore sweater with Cascade 220 wool and modified drop sleeves, and I love it.
Hello, my name is Lynn Brown from Victoria, BC, Canada, and I'd like to show you my Cascade sweater by Michelle Wang. And I was a little intimidated when I started the sweater because of all the cables, but I wanted a challenge. The yarn I used was Cascades 220, and I'm very happy with the results.
Good morning, my name is Lynn, and this is my modified Hohe Locatelli's Traveler. I've used rayon and silk yarn, which I know is not great for showing off the cables, but the structure and design is excellent for the actual yarn. I added a bit of waist shaping and I made it a tunic rather than a dress. Absolutely love it. Thanks for another great knit along.
Hi everyone, it's Sue here from Wellington in New Zealand, and this is my Hohe Locatelli Rhapsody in Cables sweater, which I love knitting. Thanks Andrew and Andrea, really love the podcast, and I'll just let you see the whole thing.
Hi, my name's Tina. I'm from Sydney, Australia. I'm wearing my Dill sweater by Marie Wallen that I've knit in Daggio Mills Alpaca in their 8-ply, and I've held that with Tandy Polworth in their 4-ply. And this little crochet applique as well, which I really like.
Hi, I'm Christy. I'm from Exmouth in a very remote part of Western Australia. This is my Vivian by Isolde Teague, and I've knitted it in Knit Picks Wool of the Andes Superwash Bulky in the Garnet Heather colourway. So changes I've made, I inserted holes for the thumbs. On the inside of the zipper, which I did by hand, I've added this decorative ribbon to neaten the edges. And then just on the side here, I have my own little personalised label. I'm wearing the Elizabeth III sweater, which is a design by Alice Starmore from Tudor Roses 2013. It's knitted in the Virtual Yarns Hebridean 2-ply in golden cover. It's got this absolutely beautiful cable detail with V-shaped panel around the neckline, which is repeated on the back as well.
I want to quickly talk about the cowls that we're doing. Last episode we announced the lace garment or hap cowl. So many of you have already entered that and are talking about your fantastic projects and showing them in the thread on Ravelry. Thank you so much. That's so exciting. I have to admit, though, I do get a bit jealous when I see these great projects. It's hard to watch and to sit back and not knit.
Keep your hands still.
Keep my hands still. But well done. Thank you so much. If you'd like to join in this cowl, go over and check out the rules and regulations. But basically, it has to be a large project, a garment or a large hap or shawl, and at least a third to a half of it has to be in lace. So I want you to take the challenge to go the very next step in your lace knitting journey. And that's why I'm giving you a lot of time. You'll see the deadlines. And if there's enough intricate projects there in the cowl, then I'll extend the deadline. So don't make a deadline determine what you're going to do. The other thing I want to say is there's some fantastically experienced, wonderful lace knitters joining in this cowl, which I'm thrilled about because their work really provides such great inspiration for everybody. But if you're a beginning knitter, don't hold back. Please come and join. Because we have to start wherever we are. So pick a project that's just a little step up from where you are, but that you're inspired by to do. And if you've got, join in the conversation, join in the discussions. If you've got questions, don't hold back. Don't feel like, oh, maybe it's going to come across as a silly question, because chances are if you want to know it, somebody else does too. So, and they'll be grateful for you asking it, and the advanced knitters would be very happy to answer and help you. So please don't feel intimidated.
Yep.
All join in. And we've got a hashtag. It's going to be the Fruity Lace Cowl. So start tagging your work.
Yep. We'd love to see what you're doing. So do that on Instagram.
Yeah.
Yep.
The next cull I want to announce to you is called the You and Me cull. So we will hashtag it with Fruity You and Me cull. The first time I ran the idea for this cull by our Shetland patrons, it was met with a reserved response. But I really want to do this cull, so I thought I'm going to have to think this through a little bit more and try to make it more attractive for people. So the idea is that you have to do two garments or two large shawls, and they have to be connected in some way. One you're going to knit for yourself, and the other one you're going to knit for a very special person, a loved one. So it could be your partner, it could be a parent, it could be your child, it could be a very, very dear friend. That's why it's called the You and Me cull. These projects have to be connected in some way. So they have to be connected either by, so a typical example, what I would like to do for Andrew and I is to make matching ferrule vests. Now, they don't have to be matchy-matchy, as in exactly the same.
Identical.
But I would do my colourway for me, his colourway for Andrew, maybe more feminine design for me, but they're connected. I'd probably use the same wool and they would look similar. Okay, and the whole idea is that when you're working on your project and you're working on the project for the person that you're making it for, you're concentrating and grateful and thinking about the great relationship that you're very grateful for. And then when you wear them, you're thinking and celebrating your relationship.
Dolls, that's so sweet.
It is so sweet. And that's why I want to do it.
Are you going to make something?
Yeah, I'm going to make something.
Yeah, except you're not knitting.
I'm not knitting now, but I will do it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And tell me, the second garment, right, the you garment is obviously for you. Well, me garment is for you.
Yeah.
The other garment, does it have to be a big garment or does a child qualify? Because maybe some people have a special relationship. You know,
absolutely. It doesn't have to be your lover. It can be your parent. It can be your child. It can be your best friend.
Dog?
It can be your dog.
Okay.
Because you can, you know.
Maybe I could make our dog a shawl.
Okay, so let me move on and give some more examples. So if you're wanting to do two shawls or two haps, for instance, you could use the same colourway on two different designs. That could be very interesting to see how that plays out. Or you could do the same design using two colourways. I first got this idea from the Rowan's latest magazine because they have some great combinations of adult child variations on the same pattern. You can see here on the cover, this is a lovely ferrule summer cardigan for an adult, and then they've got a child's version in a different colourway. They've got that theme right through this book. If I try to find another example, you can see here we've got a male jumper here, a jumper for a man and a jumper for a child that could be unisex. The jumpers also could be unisex. They're different colourways, but they're pretty similar in theme. That's really cute. So you could have a lot of fun doing that. Here's a cabled cardigan for a male. And here's the same pattern for a girl. And again here, here's a lovely cabled jumper, summer jumper for a male here, but that's also unisex. And here it is in a child's version. This really sweet little vest, which is shown on a boy, but it could be a unisex thing, is also here as an adult. So there were some great examples here which first inspired me, but Tin Can Knits have this. They do this variation on a theme all the time between children and adults or male, female. You could really go to town and knit your whole family. Matchy-matchies.
You're making me think of Kath and Kim dolls.
Yeah.
And some Ken Doan jumpers.
Or some... Matching Ken Doan. Exactly. Or some matchy onesies.
Oh. Crikey.
But you don't have to do the full-on matchy-matchy thing unless that's your thing. But you could have a lot of fun experimenting and coming up with two garments that are connected, significantly connected. Over the next few episodes, I'm going to research and find some examples of what you could use as inspiration for you. But you can have a lot of fun thinking how you can connect two projects together meaningfully.
Yep. We'll put the thread up. And you can put your ideas up there too, because I'm certainly interested to hear what other people think of.
Yes.
But I think it's cute. I think the idea is cute, and I stand by you, Andrea.
Thank you.
Even if you can't nip me the,
I will.
The feral vest I right will. Now. Yeah.
Because I think it's just a great way to celebrate your relationship. And they used to, in some countries in the past, like in Denmark, for a while, knitting was forbidden because it was considered a bit magical, because I suppose you're spending so much time, you're putting so much energy in, and perhaps men were even a little bit scared about women knitting magic into their stockings.
I think that's fair enough.
So in a positive way, you're investing so much love and energy into this project, which you're doing for yourself and you're doing for your loved one, and you can remember each other later. So I like the theme. I hope you do too and you join in. I'm going to show you how I pick up stitches around the neckline using my Catherine Parr as an example. How the neckline fits and looks is really noticeable, so it's worth taking the extra time to make it look just right. People tend to look at the neckline because it's right next to your face, and it's also an area that really needs to fit your body well. So you can fudge mistakes on other parts of the garment, but mistakes usually show up at the neckline, so just be prepared to undo it a couple of times if you need to. So the edge stitches of the fabric are really important because that's where you'll be picking up your stitches from. There's a few different ways to work your edge stitches so that the sides of your knitted fabric don't become loose and sloppy. What I do is always knit the first and the last stitches of every row, no matter what the pattern says. So that means that on a stockingette, on the purl side, I would knit one, purl to the last stitch, knit one. And on this cabled pattern, no matter what the pattern says, I knit the first stitch, work the pattern, knit the last stitch on both the right side of the fabric and the wrong side of the fabric. And that keeps the edges straight and makes it easy to pick up the stitches from. There are basic ratio proportions for picking up the right number of stitches along an edge, but that depends on what kind of border you're going to knit and how much stretch is in the border. But on a diagonal edge, you can roughly pick up 3 stitches for every 4 rows. And on a cast off edge, like this would be, I've still got my stitches live, you would pick up a stitch into every cast off stitch or every column. You don't have to worry about getting the exact number of stitches picked up straight off. You can pick up roughly what you need, more or less, doesn't matter, and then on the very next row, decrease or increase to get the right count. You can also knit through the back loop on the following row to tighten up any loose stitches. There's a few things you want to avoid doing. Avoid picking up into holes. And holes typically happen in a corner, for example, right here. So what you want to do is pick up into the spaces on either side of a hole, and that'll pull the knitting together and close up that hole. And pick up into any solid-looking bumps or stitches rather than gaps. This also helps to create a solid fabric and join. So what we've got here, for example, I could put my needle through here. And if I give it a tug, you can see that's going to create a hole. So rather than putting my needle in here, I would go down one and put my needle in there. And if I tug that, you can't see any hole being created. So you have to use your own judgment, and that's what you go for. For this pattern, Alice Darmore tells you to pick up more stitches than you need. So that's all written in her pattern, and she writes her patterns very well. So I'm going to be picking up 25% more stitches than I'll need, and then in the very next row, I'll decrease down to the number I need. So here you can see I have my front neck edge stitches live, and I'm just keeping them on a spare circular needle. And at the back, I have my back neck stitches still live. I'm told I have to pick up 25 stitches along here. So how do you organise that? A good thing to do is to roughly divide the space. I know I have to do 20 stitches from here, from this green pin down to here. So I just put that together like that, put a pin in here, and that marks the halfway mark. Then put that pin with the beginning, put another pin in, that marks the quarter mark. Put these two together and a pin in there. And that's subdivided it. Now I know I only have to do 5, 5, 5, and 5. So that's much easier for me to spread out 5 stitches evenly in that amount than to think of spreading out 20 stitches evenly from here to here. I've knitted across the front edge live stitches. Now I'm ready to pick up again on this diagonal front neck edge. And the corner bits here can be the potentially loose bits or the holy bits. And if I picked up that thread there, you could see I'd create a hole. So I'm going to go under 2 there. If I pick that up, you can see that's not going to have any hole. So 5 stitches, reasonably even. You can see there's a bit more of a gap there, but that doesn't matter. So here you have it. I've picked up all of my stitches and I'm ready to work my neck pattern. And in my very next row, I have to decrease 25 stitches. And so I'm going to be doing that by knitting 3 stitches, then knit 2 together, knit 3, knit 2 together, and that'll bring it in. You can see here that I've finished the collar right up to the end. I now just have to cast off my stitches, and where I picked up my stitches was back down here underneath these 2 rows of garter stitch. And if I just sort of pull it apart a little bit, you can see that it's quite seamless. There's no holes anywhere. So that's worked well.
In our last episode, Andrea spoke to Gail Rohm. Gail Rohm teaches Western knitters how to read and interpret Japanese knitting patterns and opens up a whole world of new and innovative designs to Western knitters and English-speaking knitters. Gail Rohm will be our guest on our next, at our next Fruity Knitting Live event, which is open to our Shetland patrons. Merinos will also get a recording of that event. If you are a Shetland or a Merino patron, you can put in your questions for Gail on the Patreon post. So while the interview is still fresh in your mind,
yes,
please put in your questions. If you've got anything that Gail mentioned in the interview that you'd like to hear more about, then that's your opportunity. So
yeah,
that's something to look forward to. I wanted to give a quick mention to our Patreon campaign. Producing this show takes a lot of work. Andrea is pretty much full-time producing the program. She has scaled back her other work that she does, not completely yet, but it's certainly becoming less to make more time, less late night work, less weekend work.
Yeah.
But that's certainly not gone either. We use Patreon as a means to allow our viewers and people who want to support us to make a regular financial contribution to the show. And I think it's a really great platform for that. It's really flexible. It's easy. It allows you to choose how much you want to contribute and when you want to stop. That's all completely open.
Yeah.
It's not an ongoing commitment in any way. So if you do want to see the show continue, please check out the Patreon page. You can find the link below. It does have a lot of information there. If you have questions, you can put them to us via the Ravelry page, or you could, if you need to, you can send it directly to Andrea at Fruity Knitting. So on Ravelry again. But yeah, we are really depending on individual support for that. We have a target that we've set for ourselves where we can say that the program is safe and it will continue into the future. We're getting towards that, but we are certainly not there yet. We need more supporters to make that safe. So please check that out and consider whether you can help us in that way.
And thank you to all of our viewers and to all of our patrons. We really appreciate it.
Absolutely.
We're now up to the interview with Tom van Dienen, Tom of Holland. It was so great to talk to Tom. He's very interesting because of all of the many rabbit holes that he burrows into and the very thoughtful process he takes with all of his crafty endeavours. We both met him at Edinburgh. He was teaching workshops there at the Edinburgh Yarn Festival. He was charming and lovely, as you're soon going to see. So we hope that you really enjoy this interview. Thank you for spending time with us, and we look forward to seeing you in 2 weeks.
Yep. Thanks very much for watching us. We appreciate your time, and we look forward to the next show in 2 weeks' time, as yes. Andrea said.
Bye.
Bye.
Welcome to the Fruity Knitting Podcast. My guest today is Tom van Dienen, known in the fibre and textile world as Tom of Holland. Tom is a self-taught textiles practitioner based in the UK. He loves to work with wool and is particularly attracted to the traditional techniques for both creating and repairing garments. Tom feels that the repairing process is as important an art form as the initial creating process. This is because it allows him to highlight the relationship between the garment and its wearer. Each beautifully mended repair holds a story which adds to the value of the garment. Tom has explored making and remaking garments and other articles using a variety of needlecraft skills and documents his work on his very popular blog. It's an honour to have you with us, Tom, so thank you very much for being here and a warm welcome to the Fruity Knitting Podcast.
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure.
Tom, you're self-taught in a number of different needle and textile crafts. Was there a chronological order as to how you learnt these crafts? For example, did you learn one and then that inspired you to learn another? Or right from the beginning, have you had a wide range of interests?
I've always had a wide range of interests. My mum's a really good knitter. I remember my granny knitting as well. I remember her showing me how to knit socks, although I didn't actually learn from her because I was too young at the time. And also I enjoyed doing a little bit of crochet. Like I made teeny tiny doilies for my grannies. You know, you could just about put an egg cup on it and that was it. I've always embroidered and all sorts of things. Yeah, I don't really know where it came from or, you know, there's no real chronological order in which I've learned things. I've always dabbled in needlework and textiles, you know, not always with as much thought as I put in right now, but I've always enjoyed it. And even as a teenager, I've been repairing and fixing my own clothes here and there. Also, my grandparents had sheep, and although they never really pushed wool because they kept sheep for meat, I think I've kind of absorbed the early wool fumes from going to the barn and being really excited when, you know, the lambing season was upon us. And, you know, it was a very special time always. So, yeah, I've always enjoyed textiles.
And you've been attracted to the technical side of making garments. Why is that attractive to you or interests you?
I think I've always been interested in how you can make things, and I've always been interested in how you can put things together and trying to make things last. And so to make things last, I like to get the best results so it looks good and it lasts long. And I think understanding how something is made will help you make a nice, like in this case, a garment. So I'm really interested in learning all the different techniques and see how things fit together and learn about when a particular technique might be useful for a particular situation, like different types of cast-ons with knitting will give you different results, excuse me, depending on what you want to achieve. I'm recently really into the three-needle bind-off for seaming, which I think is a very nice technical way of dealing with things. I really like, for instance, this book here, Knitting Lace, because Susanna Lewis, she really breaks down how lace is constructed, and she uses a really old sampler from, I think, the 1880s or thereabouts, and she breaks it down and explains exactly, you know, if you do a decrease to the left or to the right, how does it affect the bias of the fabric and putting yarn overs together with the decrease or spacing them apart gives you a different effect. And in the back, there's a whole section on how to get that together and learning and little swatches that you can make yourself to explore those effects that you can apply in lace knitting. And likewise, another book that I really like, it's one of my Bibles. I know it's a little bit controversial for some people, the Principles of Knitting, written by Junes Hammonds Hyatt. And it goes into very great detail. You know, you can see how thick it is.
Yes.
It's loads and loads of pages. And it's just technique. You know, that's all that's in it. Not a single pattern to be found. And I've literally read it from cover to cover.
And recently you've been researching old techniques for working with various textiles, particularly needlework and tailoring.
Yes.
And you've been working your way through the female handicrafts, which is an old Dutch lesson plan to teach girls the fine art of making and darning.
Yep.
That sounds really interesting to me, particularly because you said that the old techniques might take longer, but sometimes they work better than the modern shortcuts. So can you talk a bit about that and maybe even give some examples?
Yeah, I really enjoy learning about traditional techniques. I've had the book in my possession for a few years already. It's a Dutch book. It's a lesson plan. It was originally written in 1880 or thereabouts. And it was written for teachers to teach children how to do the marking of linen. So all your household's linens, they used to be marked because lots of people took things to the wash house, the marking, so putting on little initials. I've got a little example here. This could have been made by somebody, you know, being taught from that book. So you can see the JH and
some very beautiful
teeny tiny darns. So, and also here at the back, so that's the back. So you can see it's all done in color, and that was so that the student could really see what she was doing. And also it would allow the teacher to show, to see any mistakes. And that's what I really like about these samplers. The aim, of course, is that in the end, the repairs are completely invisible. But the way to learn it means that you use colored threads, and it makes very beautiful small practice textiles. I've been repairing tea towels, so I've been using techniques explained in the book. It's called a hemmed patch. So it's a technique used for things that need very frequent washing because it's a very strong repair. What I enjoy about that is not necessarily that all the techniques are always better, but I enjoy just all the detail and the detail to attention, because I think in the olden days, the importance of repairing was that because textiles and clothes were very expensive, so everybody repaired, but they always tried to do it invisibly so you couldn't see it. And now I think that's where all the different techniques come from. It's always trying to find the best technique to do it as invisible as possible. And that is dependent on how practical does the repair need to be. So, for instance, the tea towel with the hemmed patch is very strong, but it's also visible because you will always have that little doubled up border. Whereas a patch in a suit, you can make that look almost completely invisible, but you wouldn't want to wash it because it would just fall apart very easily.
So talking about doing things from hand, you've just been hanging around Savile Row recently and you've been picking up the tricks of the trade from some extremely specialised and expert craftspeople who do a lot of things by hand. That sounded wonderful. So tell us a little bit about it. What was it like to hang out with them? And maybe you've got a story you can share with us.
Yeah, I really enjoyed that. So the reason I wanted to do that is because of the tea towels, it meant I was doing a lot of stitching by hand because I wanted to use the old techniques. And of course, you know, a small sewing needle, you know, I can't even...
Yes.
Teeny
wow,
tiny one like
that's
that.
That's very small.
It's almost as sharp at the eye end as it is at the thing that goes through the fabric. So you know, it really, my fingers are starting to shred to bits. And so I wanted to use a thimble. So I've written a blog post too about the tailor's thimble, which looks like this. You put it on your middle finger and then you can sew. And you do it like that. Anyway, so I wanted to learn more about hand stitching techniques, and then I thought about tailors because they use a lot of hand stitching, the traditional Savile Row tailors in London. I wanted to meet up, and I've managed to organise that. And I went to Geeves and Hawkes on number one Savile Row. Some people might know it as the place where Alexander McQueen did his apprenticeship. I spent an afternoon with Jules Walker, who is the military finisher. And a finisher in the tailoring trade is the person that will sew in the lining of a suit. He or she will make the buttonholes, sew on the buttons, you know, do all the finishing. The tailor would be the person who will stitch all the pieces of cloth together. And then there's also a cutter, and the cutter will actually measure up the client, discuss any style details they want in the suit, and then they will, you know, cut the cloth. So they all three have different specialized areas. So yeah, so there's lots to learn, and I've already made a few buttonholes by myself, but once we went through learning how to just hold a needle and the thimble, which luckily I managed to teach myself already before I turned up in not too bad a way, I started practicing buttonholes. So here's just a few, they're not the best ones, but you know, the top one is an early example, and then the bottom one is the latest yes. one I made.
Well, so the bottom one certainly looks very beautiful.
Thank you. And yeah, and this is a bit of lining, which I've stitched in with a fell stitch, as it's called in the tailoring trade. And normally you would use a thread that's the same color as the lining, and then the stitches wouldn't show at all. And then okay. I just see teeny tiny blips.
What was it like being in that atmosphere with Jules? Was it very eye-opening?
It was, because, you know, Geeves and Hawkes are very, you know, well-respected tailors. And, you know, you go to the shop and everything looks absolutely spit-spot, and all the people that work there on the shop floor, they have beautiful suits. They're all the bespoke suits, handmade. No, they must cost thousands of pounds. And then I go to the workroom, which is downstairs, and there's lots of very bright lights because you want to be able to see what you do. But, you know, it's quite a contrast to the actual shop floor that the customer would see. I really enjoyed it. Everybody was very welcoming and willing to show what they're working on to somebody who's very, you know, interested in what they do.
I'm sure your passion made them excited about sharing their knowledge.
Yeah, I hope so.
Let's talk now about your visible mending program, because you've been learning how to do things beautifully invisibly, but you have quite a well-known program, which is a visible mending program. So how did that happen?
I'm not that good at invisible mending. And when I first started out, when I was quite a bit younger, you know, I just didn't manage to do anything invisible because I was being quite clumsy. I started make things visible because that was in a way easier. Although, you know, downside of using a contrasting thread, of course, for instance, means that any mistakes will show up really clearly. So for me, it's still very important to use good technique because that's the only way you can make it look nice. Well, at least in a way that I would be happy with. For me, if the Visible Mending Program is a way of sharing inspiration, skills and services, and I do that by writing a blog, and you know, I'm active on Instagram and other social media. So, you know, I like to share the things that I do and write about the techniques that I use and things that I've learned when I go, for instance, to somebody like Keith and Hawks. I like to share my skills by running workshops and doing that kind of stuff. And services, you know, not everybody has the inclination to pick up needle and thread all the time. So I take on repair commissions.
And part of doing a visible mending is, I think I've read that you like to make a repair like a badge that tells more of a story about the garment.
Yeah, yeah. So for me, I've been making my own clothes for quite a while now. And you put in a lot of time and effort and skill in making your own clothes. You need to think about what yarn you want to buy, if you're knitting, or what fabric, what pattern. If you want to repair shop-bought clothes, then you don't really have that same, you know, engagement with the garment because it's already there. And for me, doing a visible repair, you can put in something of yourself again because it allows you to be creative, and then you end up with, a beautiful batch as a darn, as a badge of honour.
Yes, that's a lovely description. So you do love to work with wool. Are you able to share with us some immediate tips and tricks for darning woolens?
Darning woolens, I think the main things to think about is whether it's going to be a functional darn or a decorative darn. So functional darn, for instance, on socks, you've got a hole in your sock. You want to make sure that your socks are still comfortable. So you try to match your thread thickness or use something slightly thinner, and try to use a technique that isn't lumpy and bumpy. So like, for instance, here, there's all reinforcement actually with Swiss darning and an actual stocking darn, you know, the one with the mushroom.
Yes.
And a long needle. But if you want to do something decorative, for instance, this green jumper.
Wow.
You know, that's quite a different story. But it's, you know, it still works in progress. But I'm using the different texture and different color. Doesn't matter because, you know, it's a jumper, so I don't have to walk on those lumpy, bumpy bits.
And was that a story of moths, that jumper?
Yeah, lots and lots and lots of moths.
So I'd like to talk also with you about your project with Felicity Ford of Knitsonic called the Aleatoric Fair Isle, and that's where some elements of the creative process are deliberately left to chance.
Yeah.
That sounds great. I can understand why you'd want to do that, because it helps to break preconceived ideas about what looks good together, and it also helps you come across some creative surprises. So can you explain to the audience, first of all, what the project was and what you learned from it?
Yeah, Aleatoric Fair Isle. It's a way of trying to knit your fair isle patterns using chance to come up with your patterns and your colours. It's something that Felix and I have struggled with fair isle knitting. We both really enjoy it and really admire fair isle knitting. And we down south always struggle, you know, that's how we call it, us down south, we're all very precious about our fair isle knitting. We were really finicky about trying to put the patterns together and, you know, maybe put in much more thought than a Shetland knitter might do, who has grown up with the tradition, instinctively knows what things go together, colors, patterns, and why something would work. If a pattern doesn't fit in the repeat all around perfectly, they will just increase or decrease a couple of stitches in that row and continue, and, you know, don't really worry about it too much. Whereas we always spent loads of time trying to get just the right color and do lots of swatching and never really feeling that sure about what was going on. As we both admire John Cage, who is a 20th century composer, who uses a lot of chance operations, so leaving things to chance to try out, to try to create a piece of music. We really like that idea. So what John Cage did, you might use dyes or some other method of that thing letting that thing make the choices for him. So we might come up with a set of rules, and then roll the dice. If it was an even number, this would be the next bit in this composition. If it was an odd number, that might happen. We used the ideas of John Cage and his chance operations and want to apply them to knitting. So we came up with rules of how to what patterns to knit. We had a book with patterns in it. We had some collars put together, and then we just keep rolling the dice until we were, had written down a pattern, and then we would follow it religiously. When you begin following the rules as you set them out, but you don't have any choice in what comes up next, you start knitting, then there comes a point where what the rules have taught you to do is not really what you want to do, because it doesn't look right. And by doing all these swatches and using the process again and again, you start to understand what it actually is you don't like. So is it the colors don't quite go together, or maybe the patterns don't fit well, or maybe I've chosen to knit something horizontally, but it might look better vertically or the other way around. So we've been playing around with that. And this is actually the first ever aleatoric fair our swatches are made. So we had lots of rules, and it would take us maybe 10 or 15 rolls of the die to work out what patterns would go together and whether we would knit them patterns facing this way or vertically. And also the color changes, how would they progress through the swatch. And really enjoyed it. And it kind of makes you, sometimes swatches come out looking very nice already. For instance, I really like this one.
Yes, lovely.
Yeah, thank you. So, I didn't do anything different from what the rules told me, but I really liked it. And there's a color I really don't like, which is purple. I'm just not a purple person, so to speak. So I've taken that swatch and used all the purpley shades and knitted the same pattern, but using purples instead of all the browns and the rusty colors. Yeah, and then I knitted this swatch here. So here the patterns are actually knitted vertically.
Okay, yes.
Yeah, I'm not too mad about the colors, but I did actually like these patterns. So when Magnus from Fula Wool asked me to design a cardigan for him using Fula Wool, I'm wearing it right now. I used this swatch, but I turned it the right side up, so to speak. So you can see how I've started using the patterns that were in this swatch.
Yes. Wow.
Yeah. So the aleatoric fair are, for me and also for Felix, just taught us a lot about how colors fit together and patterns fit together, and particularly how, as a person, everybody has different sensibilities. So how I feel certain colors fit together and how Felix feels certain colors fit together, and they might not always be the same, but by forcing yourself to follow the rules, you start to learn when you don't like something and why.
And using chance like that just forces you outside of your own boundaries all the time, doesn't it?
Yeah.
I can see that often the middle line is in a lighter colour.
Traditional patterns often have, traditional knitters, they might, when they have yarn that's precious for whatever reason, it might be they don't have much of it, or it's dyed with a rare dye, or, it's expensive, whatever, then they often use the middle row just to use a little bit of that special color, and then it would only be that row, and the rest would be they would use yarns and colors that they had much more of. So that middle row is a bit of a special row.
Is that a good starting point? Then if you start with your precious color and you see how can you enhance it?
Yeah, I think so, because if it's a special color for whatever reason, that'd be nice if you can use it, and then you want to use it in such a way that you can show it off. So it might be a good starting point.
Great. Okay, well, we can talk about that for a very long time, but we'll move on.
Oh, yes.
So you have been doing some collaborations lately, and particularly with the New Craftsman. So just very quickly, can you just tell us who are the New Craftsman and what are you going to be doing with them?
So the New Craftsman is a shop or a showroom in London, in Mayfair, and they represent people who like to make things, who have a deep understanding of tradition but might use them in a non-traditional way. So like the way I like to refer to the old techniques of repairing, but I use them in a different way. So they have all sorts of things in their gallery, pottery, glassware, textiles, furniture. Yeah, they've asked me if I wanted to be represented by them, and I didn't have to think too much about that because I really like the shop, and it's quite expensive, but you know, that's because they pay a reasonable price. You know, the maker actually gets paid what things are worth, I feel. I've worked with them since summer, and the first big thing that I did was actually Burberry Maker's House. So in September, Burberry presented their September collection, and it was based on crafts and, you know, traditional crafts had a kind of a background story to the collection. So they came up with this kind of pop-up shop, I suppose, and they've asked the new craftsmen to organize that, and they invited people within, you know, people on the books of the new craftsmen to come in and show their, you know, their traditional crafts. And then, like, everybody there was very talented and, you know, really knew what they were doing. And although lots of them would refer back to old techniques or traditional techniques, the things that they make, you know, they're all very modern and beautiful. I've made some things for them for the showroom. So I've repaired vintage Welsh blankets. The tea towels that I showed you, I make more of those. And actually also knitted pencil cases.
So I'd like to finish now with the last question, and that is to do with the growing interest in slow fashion. So slow fashion is having well-made clothes that could last a lifetime, and there's various different motivations for doing that. But just tell us now, what have you learned from your experience of making your own clothes, and has that experience changed your views on anything?
I don't think it's changed my use very much. I've always, from ever I was very young, bought clothes to wear for a longer period of time. I never was really into super fashionable things that, you know, you wear for one summer and then the next summer people say you look ridiculous. That's not to say I might have had a somewhat quirky style at times, but, you know, I would always have things in my closet that I intended to wear for a long period, you know, like years. And even if it's cheap, I would try to wear it. And that's how I started repairing things, because if you wear something a lot, you get stains or whatever. And then I started to make my own clothes, and I really got into, because I'm interested in the technical side of things, you know, I start to look at how clothes that I buy in the shop are put together. And you start to understand that, you know, I might spend months or, you know, months on knitting a sweater for myself because I also have a different job. Or sewing a pair of trousers takes me 2 weeks just because I'm really particular and I don't like to rush things. I realize that the people that make those clothes that you buy in the shop are also very, very skilled people. The difference there is that they will be given either cheap materials, or they've been asked to churn out loads and loads of garments in a short space of time. So that's why the quality suffers. And I feel by making my own clothes, I started to understand what was going on there, and how a really cheap T-shirt from Primark isn't really, you know, that doesn't feel right for me, because somebody's losing out there, and there's these skilled people that never get acknowledged. I think by making my own yarn, so I started spinning a couple of years ago, you know, I really start to think about the processes behind the materials that you use. You know, if you process your own wool, it takes water. If you want to dye it, you have to use chemicals or natural dye, and in either case you need to gather those things. It takes more water. So if you scale it up to industrial sized production, you can understand how much that takes. And for me, that makes me want to make my own clothes more than I do already. You know, I do still buy clothes, but I feel even more inspired to make my own things. So even if I don't always spin my own yarn, or, you know, I don't even know how to weave, maybe sometime in the future, if I make things myself, then at least that's the part that I have control over. If you're interested in sustainable fashion or slow fashion, it's very easy to feel daunted and to be overwhelmed by all the issues that sit around fashion. I think people need to understand that everybody has their own capabilities and everybody has their own way of dealing with things. And if it's an issue that concerns you, then don't get panicked by, oh, I need to make everything myself. No, just, you know, I think try to do what you can and feel that even that is a contributions.
And also I can see that that's probably just the joy of having a garment that you've made yourself that fits you really well, that's tailor-made to yourself. That's extremely attractive. And I can see that's probably driven your passion into learning techniques, hasn't it?
Definitely, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. That's great. Well, it's been such fun to talk to you and hear about all of your adventures because they're quite varied, aren't they?
They are quite varied, yes.
So it'll be exciting to hear what you get up to next if you do go into weaving.
I do have already a few books on weaving, so it's only a matter of time.
Thank you so much for joining us on the podcast and we'll say goodbye now to the audience.
Oh, well, thank you so much for having me. I really enjoyed our chat.
Great. Okay. Bye.
Bye.